So we are in a sermon series called The Gospel of Grace, and we're actually working through the book of Galatians. How many of you have read the book of Galatians, small book? I would encourage you to go and read this small book. Last week we spent some time talking about the gospel of grace. The gospel in its original language in the Greek is the word evangelion. We get the English word evangelist. A lot of things probably come to mind when you think of an evangelist. Maybe some good, maybe some bad. But simply what that means is that they are people who are bringing the good news of Jesus. So if there's a good news of Jesus, then there must be bad news, right? The Bible makes it clear that there is bad news. If you look through your Bible, it doesn't take you too long to find Genesis chapter 3. Genesis 1 and 2, everything is good. Genesis 3, then all of a sudden we hear the bad news for the first time. The bad news is this, is that though man was created in God's image, we rebelled against our holy creator, God. The Bible calls this act of rebellion sin. And so here's kind of like what it might look like, and I'll use this as an illustration. So here's our creator. He creates us, and he creates us in his image, and all is good. Genesis 1, Genesis 2. Genesis 3, man disobeys a holy God. And the Bible calls this sin. This represents sin. So now we have this sin nature. Now, there might be people who offer up offerings, but they still have this sin nature. There might be people who have heard of God's word, the law, and have tried to keep the law, but they're still sinful people who keep the law. There might be people who do good works, but they're simply people who are sinful that do good works. And so this sin issue is something that we can't get rid of on our own. That's bad news. In fact, the bad news is that it's such an offense to a holy God that it separates us from God. He is perfect. He is holy. He's without sin. We are sinful people. Now, the good news is this. Here's the evangelion. Here's the good news is that God so loved the world, some of y'all know this, that he sent Jesus Christ into the world. And so imagine, if you will, the throne room of heaven, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Alpha, Omega, always was, always will, always will be, that God sends his son, Jesus, on a rescue mission, and he is born of a virgin, and he becomes like us. Emmanuel, God is with us. He is man. Fully God, fully man. Now, the difference between us and Jesus is this, is that we still are sinful, and he is without sin, right? So he lives 33 years on this earth, and he is pointing the way back to the Father. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And so man, now a sinful, rebellious man, are being drawn by the power of the Holy Spirit to the Son, Jesus. Jesus Christ goes to the cross. It's a sinner's cross, but here's the irony. He is without sin, and he hangs on a tree. The Bible says that he who knew no sin actually becomes sin. The sins of humanity are placed upon him at the cross, and he dies. Now, this is pretty powerful stuff, because here is at this moment in time, the Father. This is hard to get our mind around. I was talking to Ken Black about this the other day, is that the Father turns his back upon the Son at this time. Father, why have you forsaken me? This is the reason why the Father turns his back upon the Son, is because now the Son has sin. Not his sin, but your sin, my sin, our sin. And so he dies. According to the scriptures, he is buried. And on the third day, he rises again, glorified body, no sin. Sins back into glory and sits at the right hand of the Father. So when we die now, those who have placed our faith in not ourselves, not our works, not anything we do, but rather in the work of Christ, our Savior, then we are forgiven. Our sin is placed upon him at the cross and buried and paid for. So when he ascends into glory, the Father looks at us and he doesn't see our sin anymore. He sees the righteousness of Christ in us. We are a new creation. Old things have gone, new things have come. We have been forgiven, not by what we do, but by the work of Christ. This is the good news. Why wouldn't we want to share this good news with the world? We share all sorts of other good news. I just saved 15% on insurance, car insurance. That's good news, right? But there's what the Bible says, good news, that Jesus Christ came to seek and save which was lost. People like you, people like me, people who don't know anything about investing, real church, real people, all of us. So we're talking about the gospel. The gospel is the good news. Grace is something that we don't do. It's something he has done for us. It is free. And that is a gift from God. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. You don't earn it. You don't work for it. It is given to you. That's a beautiful thing. The Apostle Paul is writing this letter to this church in Galatia. And actually, it's a circulated letter. And in this letter, he is going to defend the gospel of grace. And if you were here last week, that's how he opened up the scriptures. And so today we're going to continue on with this theme. And we're going to shift gears just a little bit, and we're going to talk about the power of a changed life. See, the gospel changes you for all eternity. Once you understand the gospel and you place your faith in Jesus Christ, you're forgiven of your sins and you have a place in eternity. The Bible says that you now are a citizen of heaven. You have a citizenship that is in heaven. Think about those terms today when we talk about citizenship in the United States. We talk about all the paperwork and all the things that you have to be a legal citizen. Well, when you become a Christian, you have now a citizenship in heaven. You don't have to do anything for it. It's all done on your behalf. You stand before God in his glory, and you get to take part in the kingdom because of the work that he has done. So you're not only saved for eternity, but here's where a lot of Christians don't talk about. You're actually saved to have a different life here on this earth, a changed life. That's what a Christ follower is. It's not simply just carrying the good news in word, but it's doing things for the kingdom as well, because he has now changed your heart, changed your life. And I'll give you an example, because Ephesians 2, 8, 9 talks about we don't do anything to get saved. But Ephesians 10, which we don't like to talk about, but reminds us that we are saved so that we might do good works. Works don't save you, but after you follow Christ and have been changed, you now are a different person. You live for him. The Apostle Paul is no different, and he's going to share his story. We call this a testimony. How many of you have ever heard of someone's testimony? It's kind of a big word, testimony. It sounds real legal. It's just basically sharing your story. How many of you shared your story? How many of you could, if I were to ask you to come up here, you could share your story on a spot within 3 minutes. Raise your hand if you want to come. No, I'm just kidding. That's right. You should be ready to do it. So let's take a look at the Apostle Paul. He's going to walk us through his story. Ooh, can't read that one. I'm going to look over here. Galatians 1, verse 11. It's the gospel that changes lives. It says, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel, the good news that I preach, is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by the revelation of Jesus Christ himself. Paul is starting to tell us the good news. If you are familiar with his story is found in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 8 is when he's on the road to Damascus. You remember this story? Some of y'all? Okay, so he's on the road to Damascus, and he receives what we would call his conversion, because he's blinded by the light. You remember that song back in the 70s? Yeah, that's blinded by the light. Yeah, come on now. He's blinded by the light. If you look at that text, did anyone, before the light was given to him, did anyone go and share the good news with him? No. Ananias does 3 days later. He comes after he is blinded by the light. He prays for him. But why doesn't anyone share the good news? The apostles have already been commissioned with the good news. In Acts chapter 1, they've already been told to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the outermost parts of the world. They're not sharing the good news with Saul. And there's a good reason. He is going to kill him. He's a murderer. It's probably not a good idea to go share the good news with somebody who's trying to kill you. So can God save somebody without Christians even opening their mouth? Yeah, because he is God. He does all the work. Does it get us off the hook from sharing the good news, or does God want to still use us in the process? Yes, he commissions the church, us, to go and be bearers of the good news, the gospel. And so this is what the Apostle Paul is saying here. It's the good news that changes life. It wasn't from any man. He didn't hear the gospel from anyone. It was from Jesus Christ himself. Then he goes on and tells a little bit about a story. Have you heard of his story? Let's look at a story. Verse 13. And real quick, when you tell your story should be broken up in three parts. The first part is, what was your life like before you came to know Christ? Then the second part is, when did you come to know Jesus Christ as your Savior? And the third part would be, what is your life like now? If you can answer those three questions with your own story, then you're able to communicate your story. Here's Paul. We're going to kind of look at his story from those three perspectives. Past tense, verse 13, for you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism. I can't say that word. Judaism, yeah. You try to say it. And he says how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. So he has a past. His past is that he was murdering Christians and beating them. Now think about this for a moment. We as leaders in the church, we try to guard the gate as far as letting certain people in leadership roles, because it's a very responsible position, and none of us are perfect, so really none of us deserve to be in a leadership role. But what if somebody came to this church, and what if somebody applied for membership, and we just like, yeah, you know, you're a Christian, and you're going to be a member, and then they aspire to be a leader in the church, and we find out that they have murdered a couple of people. Should we let them into leadership in the church? I mean, I don't know. That's what I'm saying, because this is what's going on with Paul. He's a murderer, and if he can't be a leader in the church, then none of us should be. This is his past. We talk about the Christian forgives, but do we really forgive? Because people come to us with pasts. And it might not be murder. It might be someone who was an adulterer, someone who got divorced, or someone who, you know, whatever the case might be, got fired from the job because they were stealing from their boss, or they were very violent people, or they used to be a drunkard, or whatever the case might be. Do we say, well, you know, that you're disqualified? Or do we say, you know what, that's your past? That's how Paul was, past tense. For you have heard of my previous way of life and how he intensely persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. Verse 14, not only was he a person that had a past trying to hurt people and kill people, but he was a very self-righteous, driven person. Verse 14, I was advancing in, there's that word again, Judaism, beyond many of my own age among my people, and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my father. If you look at Philippians chapter 3, you get a little bit better picture of Paul. He says that he was a Jew among Jews. He was circumcised on the eighth day. In other words, he kept the law to a T. That he was from the tribe of Benjamin. He could trace his bloodline to the 12 tribes of Israel. So this guy was like the up-and-coming next big leader in the Sanhedrin. He was advancing above faster than any of his leaders. He was a leader among leaders, is what he's trying to say. He was zealous for the traditions of his fathers, of their fathers. So in other words, he thought he was doing all the right things, and yet he was really working against God. He was trying to know God, but he did not really want to know the love of God, because he was trying to stomp out anything that opposed the traditions of his fathers. You know, this is an interesting point here, because I kind of fall into this trap. Maybe some of you do. Maybe some of you know some people that do this, that they're very zealous for their religious beliefs because grandma did this or grandpa did that or my family's done this. And how can I? And yet you start telling them about the Bible. The Bible doesn't say any of that. And yet they become zealous about their traditions of their family versus the Word of God. That's how Paul was. He was lost. He had good intentions, but he was lost. And then you see in verse 15, here's the contrast. So that was his life before. Verse 15 is his road to Damascus experience. It's not recorded here, but we have that in the book of Acts. Verse 15 says, "But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased." I love this. That God was already at work even before the road to Damascus experience. God was at work in his mother's womb, that in your mother's womb, I knew you. And God had already set him apart in the mother's womb to do something for him. And if Paul is anything like me, or if I'm anything like Paul, then you know that you're when you're born, you're like, you know, I want to know God, but I don't know how to know him. And Paul was doing all the right things to know God, and he never really knew him. He knew the law. The law was simply a foreshadow of the one to come, Jesus. And Paul says that by God's grace, God was calling him even in his mother's womb. Now, we know in the book of Acts that he understands the gospel on the road to Damascus, and that's his conversion. And then we see in verse 16, so if your life was like this before you come to know Christ here, then what's your life like now? Verse 16 gives us a glimpse of what the future of Paul's earthly ministry would be like. It says that he called me by this grace to reveal his son in me, not to me, but in me, so that I might preach him among the who? The Gentiles. Now let's pause for a moment real quick and let's put this in context. Everything we know about Paul up until this point, he is a Jew among Jews, right? He is the one who's zealous for the traditions of the family, right? The family, the law, those types of things. Do Jews like Gentiles? In fact, if you were a Jew, you thought you were better than a Gentile. I mean, you barely tolerated Samaritans who were half Jews, half Gentiles. But if you were a Jew, there's no way in the world you would ever have dinner or fellowship with a Gentile because you would consider them dirty, unclean. Now, here's one who is a Jew among Jews, and all of a sudden now God has called him to go minister to not other Jews, but to Gentiles. The irony in that. You know, I was talking to my wife about this, I need counseling. This is not what I'm talking about, my wife, but I need counseling. In fact, my brother here, we have some visitors from Wayside this morning with us, and when I first started this church 10 years ago, God had put on my heart to reach Hispanics. So that's where I need counseling part. And my wife and I were eating breakfast at a Mexican restaurant, and there were just like all these Hispanics there. And I was like, man, this is like mi familia. This is, you know. And the irony is this, is that I can't really speak Spanish. And yet I have a heart for Hispanics. And here's the more irony, is that God is calling us to go to Castroville. I don't drive a pickup truck. I drive a minivan. If you go to the soccer fields, the soccer moms drive pickup trucks in Castroville. There's nothing wrong with that. But I'm the only guy driving a minivan. Here's the irony, is that God, wouldn't you like call me to like to reach people that are like me? Wouldn't you call Paul to reach Jews? You're calling him to reach somebody that's not even like him, and you're calling us to reach people that are not like us. That's how God is. God always wants you not to rely on your own strength, but to rely on his strength, to go where he leads you. And maybe he's even leading us even past Castroville to the outermost ends of the earth. Would you go if God calls you? Paul is. So we see this. His immediate response was not to consult any human beings. This is his conversion. Verse 17, I didn't go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was, but I went to Arabia, and later I returned to Damascus. And we're going to see in a moment that he went to Arabia for 3 years. We don't know what happened in those 3 years. It's a mystery. It's not recorded in Scripture. In fact, if you look at Acts chapter 9, I believe it's Acts chapter 9, you're going to see that Paul immediately began to preach the gospel. And then you have, I think, between verse 16 and 17, that you have this, it refers to this point. It doesn't give you a time period, but it talks about they were trying to kill him. That's probably why he didn't speak to the Jews, because the Jews were trying to kill him. He was opposing their laws. So let's transition real quick to us, just for a moment. We heard Paul tell his story. Can you tell your story? Can you tell your story? And the better question is, if you can tell your story, have you told your story? Remember your story? What was your life like before you came to know Christ? Can I tell you briefly my story? Some of y'all know my story, and I changed my story to fit the crowd. Don't lie. I mean, that's not what I'm referring to. I used to be a gang member. No. My gang name was Cupcake. I'm sorry. I get carried away. Okay. Was not a gang member. So for me, I grew up in a very, a church that I would say was very tradition-based. And I was told to do all these things in order to please God. And I alluded to some of that last week. And I'm not bashing any church by no means, because that's not what I'm about. But that was my story. My story is that, you know, I grew up, you know, being baptized as a baby. I grew up not eating meat on Friday. I grew up trying to be good. I grew up all these things. That was my life before. In fact, there was a time in my life where I was hoping there was no God. Because if there was a God, I knew deep down that I was a sinner. And I knew that I couldn't be good enough in order to get right with him. I loved God. I just didn't know his grace. I knew God, that God wanted to punish me. That was the God that I grew up knowing. When I went off to college, things got worse, because now I was away from mom and dad and there was no accountability. And so I kind of just did what I wanted to do. And I basically was living the college life, and I was in sin. That's the best way I can describe it, by keeping it PG. I was just, you know, sinful person, and I made a lot of bad choices. But God, just like Paul, but God was at work in me. And I'll be honest, he was drawing me to himself. I didn't know how that was working, but there were little things that were drawing me to him. And I joined a fraternity. And you know how I joined a fraternity? I pledged all these different fraternities. Well, I went through the rush week for all these different fraternities, and then they give you pledge cards or bid cards, and then you pledge a fraternity. And so the two that I narrowed it down to was Sigma Chi. I don't know if y'all are familiar with the Greek system, and Lambda Chi Alpha. That doesn't really matter, but this matters to me. This is my story. Sigma Chi has a cross on their shield. Lambda Chi Alpha has a cross on their shield. For whatever reason, those two things stood out to me. Out of all the fraternities, those two things stood out to me, and I was like, I got to narrow it down to one of these two. God was already at work in me. Fast forward, I went to, I was a bellman at the Harvey Hotel, DFW, and me and my fraternity brothers would basically just work for tips, and we would carry people's bags into the Harvey Hotel. And at that time, I was a hotel restaurant major at the University of North Texas, and so my desire was to go into the hospitality industry and just kind of live in the fast lane, cruise ships and casinos, and just do whatever and get paid to do that kind of life. So one day, I'm at the Harvey Hotel, and this lady walks in, and this lady goes to the front desk, and she says, can I have someone from the sales department show me a room? So the front desk people ring my little phone and bellman, and they said, hey, there's a lady here who wants to go look at a room, but all the sales reps are in a staff meeting. Can you show her a room? Sure. And I thought to myself, this is my chance to prove that I can climb this ladder from being a bellman to the front desk to the sales team to, and I'm like, this is my way in. So I introduce myself to this lady, and we go and we get on the elevator. And the elevator closes, and we go to the next floor. Bing, opens up, and then one of the housekeepers comes in the elevator. And she looks at this housekeeper, and I knew this housekeeper, and she looks at this housekeeper, and she says, do you know Jesus? And the housekeeper just like smiles. He doesn't speak English. I know this guy. I've tried to talk to him in my Spanish. And so he gets the next floor, bing, and he gets off. And I was like, ma'am, I was like, he didn't understand you. He doesn't speak any English. No habla inglés. And she looks, she goes, I could see the love of Jesus in his eyes. He knows Jesus. Thing shut. You know, you're not supposed to talk to anybody in the elevator, you know. And she looks at me in the elevator. Do you know Jesus? Oh, man. Bing, go all the way to the floor. Bing! I think I do, ma'am. Let me show you this room. So we're now in going down the hallway, and I slide the card in, open the door, draw the shades, and I'm like, hey, look at the view, the DFW airport. You can see the planes. And so I'm like, this hotel has all these amenities, and I'm just trying to do my best to sell her this room because I want everybody to know, man, you can do this as a salesperson. And she says, can I sit down for a moment? I'm a rather large woman. And she was a large woman. And she said, I just need to sit down for a moment. I'm like, okay, ma'am, go ahead. So she's on the bed, and I'm standing there like waiting for her, like, okay, you know. And she's like, can I pray for you? And I was like, I'm trying to sell you the room, you know. But God was stirring in my spirit. This was like the weirdest thing in the world that I ever encountered. And yet there was something in me that wanted her to pray because God had already been at work in me. So I walk over to her. She goes, come over here. And I'm like, okay. And she puts her hands on my head and she begins to pray over me that I might understand the gospel of Jesus. Now, you got to understand, I'm in my fraternity days. These are my partying days. These are my, you know, whatever happens at the DFW airport, Vegas stays there, that kind of mentality. I didn't really want to pursue God, but he was pursuing me. And I knew that my life was empty, and I knew that I needed him, but I just didn't know how to get to him. And I had all this religion, and this woman prays over me. And then so she finishes praying over me, and I'm like, okay, thank you, ma'am. I was like, do you want the room? And, you know, and she's like, I live down the street. I don't need no room. And I was like, well, why are you here? She's like, I was just driving by and the Holy Spirit told me to come in here. And she said, maybe it was for you. And so she left. And the front desk people said, hey, does she like the room? And I'm like, she didn't want the room. And I'm like, I'm a bad salesperson. Y'all were gone a long time. What were y'all doing? Praying? That's what I told them. And they looked at me. Yeah, right. You pray? Yeah, I know you. You're the Lambda Chi party guy. You're not going to go pray. I was like, okay. But we were praying. And she prayed for me. So now I go to my fraternity, and God sends a Campus Crusade for Christ guy into my fraternity house. And they invite the fraternity to a Bible study. And again, something in me, God's working. And I go to this Lambda Chi Alpha Bible study. And then they tell us, hey, we're going to go to Nashville, Tennessee, and we're going to have scholarships. And if you want to go to Nashville, Tennessee, you can go to this get scholarship free. We'll cover your flight, cover your hotel, cover everything. And what guy would turn down a free trip to Nashville? And I went, and I heard the gospel. The good news. And somebody got up just like me and began to preach and tell his story. And the gospel, I understood that I needed Jesus. I knew of Jesus. I just never had placed my faith in him. And I gave my life to the Lord, however you want to say that, because he gave his life for me. I placed my faith in for him. And I'm like, I'm yours, Lord. Whatever you want, forgive me of all my sin. I need a new start. And I believe God gave me a new life that day. For eternity. And I said something that I would recommend you say, but be careful when you say this. I said, Lord, I'm yours. Whatever you want from me, I'm yours. And I had no ambitions to be a pastor or church planter. I had no ambition. I wanted to be a, you know, cruise director. Ooh, big high ambitions were there. But God had other plans. And he's like, no, you know, I'm going to now use you to tell the good news. Because if I can change your life, you can help share my word so other people can have hope that they can be changed too. Not by you, James, but by my work in you, my gospel. So that's my story. And I share my story. And there's different facets to my story. Again, in context, if I'm with certain people, there's more elements to my story that I will reveal to try to connect to someone's story. But my story points to his story. And when you share your story, it should always point to his story. Don't glamorize the sin or you were in a gang or all these other things. That's not the point of your story. The point of your story is that Jesus Christ came to seek and save you, which was lost. And if he can save you, then he can save whoever you're telling your story to. And I promise you, the good thing about telling your story is that in our culture today, if you go and try to like tell people about Jesus, they're going to shut you down because like, don't push that on me. But if you share your story, they'll listen to your story. And that's what Paul was a master of. He was always relating to the Jew, became like a Jew, to the Gentile, became like a Gentile, because he wanted to tell people the work that Christ had done in his story. So that's that. And here's the 3 points real quick. Oop, did I not? Maybe I don't have it. All right, never mind. Those are the 3 points. Life before, life like now, life before Christ, when did you come to know Christ, and then what is your life like now? Hopefully your life has changed since your conversion, because it's changed once for eternity. Hopefully it has changed, and that comes from letting God work in your life, and we'll look at that later on in Galatians. But here, let's finish up this morning. Then after 3 years, I went to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter, and I stayed with him 15 days. After 3 years, guys, after his conversion, this is the first time he's getting acquainted with Apostle Peter. Verse 19, I saw none of the other apostles, only James, the Lord's brother. Verse 20, I assure you before God that what I am writing you is no lie. And then I went to Syria and Cilicia. Verse 22, I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard of my past story, the report that the man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy. And they praise God because of me. This is some pretty cool stuff here, and I won't spend too much time on this, but Paul takes 3 years. 3 years. He didn't plant these churches. These churches were already planted. If you look at these churches that in Judea that are in Christ, they didn't know Paul. So 3 years, that's where scholars speculate that he is in Arabia. Now, here's where you got to be careful with speculation, because no one knows what happens. But some people think that the Lord actually prepared him for his apostleship, because Jesus had spent 3 years with his 12. Paul only had a conversion. Paul didn't get the word from the apostles. He was alone. But those 3 years, he was with Jesus, whether it was in studying the word, whether it was understanding grace, whatever the case might be, but he was being prepared for the future. Now, for some of you, you might need some time to, if you're a young Christian, you need to get prepared for the work that God has for you. You need to learn how to share the good news. That's why we make effort to teach you from the pulpit, but also after church, we have had meetings on how to share the good news. You have to learn how to do this. You need to learn how to share your story. That's why the majority of the sermon is based on how to share a story. Some of you need to get in a small group. Some of you need to just open the Word of God for the first time, and you just need to get into the Word. But here's the key, though. If you look at his conversion, he started sharing the gospel right away. He didn't wait 3 years to start sharing the gospel. He started right away. In fact, if you go back on my timeline, in February of 1993, I became a Christian. In March of 1993, I was on a mission trip to the beach with Campus Crusade for Christ, sharing the gospel with other college students. In fact, my son today, Josh, he's not here. He's with a group of Destino, Jason Clark, Sarah Clark. They are at the beach right now, and there is a mission trip here with Campus Crusade. 35 students from San Antonio, UTSA, are sharing the gospel on the beach. And that they're on a mission. And some of these kids are probably scared, just like I was, just like you would be, but it's good news. Nothing to be scared about. Just tell them what God has done in your life and share the good news. That's all you got to do. So wherever you're at, God wants you to share the good news. And As we close today, here's a couple of questions. Man, there's no questions. I don't know what I did. The first question would be this. If there were questions, do you know how to share your story? And the second question is, who are you going to share that story with? Pray that God would put somebody in your path to share that story. Now, here's one opportunity for you to serve the Lord this summer. We're going to play a song, but after this song, I'm going to bring up a friend of mine. Well, not you, you're my friend, but my other friend from Wayside. And I pointed to the wrong person. And he's going to tell you how you might prayerfully consider going on a short-term mission trip this summer. We're going to watch a video after this song. And again, pray about that opportunity because perhaps God wants you to go.